Thank you, Thomas. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you to the MAD team for being mad in an in-sale world. Madness is sanity. It's a joy to be back in Copenhagen. You know, my early days of physics were linked to Copenhagen through the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum theory, of complementarity, of uncertainty, of potential. And what you're doing here is giving the Copenhagen interpretation of food. Food as free, food as diverse, food as nourishing, food as taste. And you've chosen the theme of guts. For me, guts is a number of meanings. The first is to have a gut sense about things. And if I'm not doing physics today, if I'm not doing quantum theory, it's because in the 80s I started to get a gut sense that something was very wrong with our agriculture systems. 1984 was the year we had the worst disaster in human history in the city of Bhopal, where a pesticide plant leaked and killed 3,000 people, 30,000 since then. And I was there for the anniversary last year, and the room was just full of children still being born crippled, because that's what poisons do. We've created an agriculture system to create bad, untasty, unhealthy, industrial food commodities through war chemicals, and we consider it smart. It was the same year we had violence and extremism in Punjab, the land of the Green Revolution. There's a lot of mythology around the Green Revolution, that it was green, it was revolutionary, nothing like it. A defense research scientist called Norman Borlaug was given the job on how to adapt plants to war chemicals. And that's what he did, created the dwarf varieties. But to pump those chemicals into agriculture, you had to destroy all the diversity. So India is talked about as getting out of the ship-to-mouth existence. Today, every second child in India is so malnourished, they are wasted and stunted. Every fourth Indian is hungry. 70% of our pulses, our dals, and our oil seeds are being imported. Because in agriculture that grew mixtures was destroyed to grow monoculture commodities of rice and wheat, 17 million tons of which rot every day. 50% of the food in the world is rotting, is being wasted. So I realized I had to look at what was happening in agriculture and did a book called The Violence of the Green Revolution. Then realized you can't just analyze it, you've got to do something about it. If you've got to be honest, then you've got to act on it. So I started to promote sustainable agriculture with the best of my understanding. And while I was at it, I get invited in 1987 to a conference where the big chemical giants, which gave us the war chemicals, were now taking over the seed through patenting, through genetic engineering, through global treaties called the GATT and now the WTO. They wrote laws and decided they were going to call themselves the inventors of life, the creators of life. Monsanto wrote the intellectual property rights agreement of WTO. That's the day my gut sense was, got to save seeds. I didn't know why, I didn't know where it would end, but I knew that I loved life and its diversity and the freedom of life so much that there was no way I was going to accept a world where five corporations controlled all the seeds of the world and all the food of the world through patenting and genetic modification. That's what they said. By year 2000, they'd be controlling everything. Today, what do we have? We have four crops. Actually, it's become three because the canola is so polluted that they can't sell the GM canola anymore except for biofuel. So it's really corn, soya, cotton. Humanity has eaten 8,500 plant species, many of them uncultivated. Today we are trading in eight, and the expansion is in corn and soya. Did the world say, give me more soya, give me more corn? Is this feeding the world? No. Only 10% of the corn and soya goes into the human food system directly. 90% is going to run cars, biofuels. And I don't call it animal feed because animals didn't want grain. They're herbivores. They wanted grass. They wanted to be free. They are being tortured with intensive feed. So it's such an inefficient system. 10% of the food destroying 75% of the planet. 75% of the species destruction because of industrial monocultures. 75% of the water being wasted on the planet because of industrial agriculture. 75% of the soils being desertified and degraded because of industrial chemical farming. And as my book, Soil Not Oil, shows, 40% of the greenhouse gases that are causing climate instability come from an industrial globalized system of agriculture. So if you do a very rough calculation, if 75% destruction is giving us around 25% overall food, 10% from corn and soya, if we were to destroy the entire planet, we'd still only reach about 33% of the food supply, which couldn't be guaranteed because if there's no soil, there's no water, there's no biodiversity, there is no food. So it is a guaranteed recipe for extinction. And yet, it's being pushed as an efficient scientific system. There's no science in it. It doesn't take science to throw war chemicals into agricultural systems. It doesn't take science to shoot with a gene gun a gene that doesn't belong to a plant. These are blind, violent technologies. And blindness is being treated as knowledge and science. So in the diversity of our crops, I remember as a child going out to my mother's farm and collecting batwa or amaranth greens. Delicious dishes. And yet with the chemical farming, these are treated as weeds, sprayed with herbicides, and destroyed. So then you have iron deficiency, and you have vitamin A deficiency. And of course, the miracle mongers are out to give miracle solutions to that, like they gave in the Green Revolution, calling the Green Revolution as based on miracle seeds. There was nothing miraculous about it. You put all the land under one crop, you're going to have lots of that crop. You put all the water to a few commodities, you're going to have more of those commodities. It's land and water that explain the fact that there are mountains of these agricultural commodities while 1 billion people starve. So two miracles they're bringing out, and just yesterday in the Sunday New York Times, there was a big thing on the golden rice and a big attack on me. 2000 is when they started selling a golden rice, selling an idea of a golden rice, not a product, to remove vitamin A deficiency. I called it then a blind approach to blindness prevention. Because the amaranths and the curry leaves and the coriander leaves that we use daily in our food give us 1,400 micrograms of beta-carotene vitamin A equivalent. Even today, after 13 years of research, they're going to be able to only put in 70% of the daily requirement. First, they said, you have to put it in rice because people can't afford vegetables. Now they say, we'll give you 70%. I say, okay, the 30% will still come from vegetables. So why not have the vitamin A from sources of rich vitamin A rather than white rice, which uses 2,500 millimeters of water? They haven't given up. The Philippines peasants have just uprooted the vitamin A golden rice trials of the International Rice Research Institute. And I do hope we'll see a closure to that chapter. But as if it isn't enough, you know, India's a land of tremendous bananas. We are the biggest producers of bananas. We are the biggest eaters of bananas, but we are not the biggest sellers at the global level. Because the bananas are gentle, they don't trade well. You need to eat them fresh. We have more than 500 varieties of bananas, the little ones, the red ones, the raw ones, the ones that make good chips, the ones that make good food, those that make good dessert bananas. Now they want to put iron into the banana. Banana is such a generous fruit. It has everything. It's called the kalpatru, the wish-fulfilling plant. And when Alexander came to India, remember he tried to invade India, and he was dazed that there were these sages eating the banana fruit. So he called it the fruit of the wise, and the scientific name of banana is Musa sapientum, the wise, the fruit of the wise. And in India, if you go into local cuisine, never in the Indian Mughlai restaurant, but in the local cuisine, particularly in eastern India or in Kerala, they use the flower of the banana for cooking, they use the stem of the banana for cooking. Of course, the banana leaf is the ultimate renewable plate. And the fruit is used for fasting, it's used for health, it's used, you know, for diarrhea, it's the most beautiful cure, but it has only 0.44 milligrams of iron. Even if they make it 4 times more, 10 times more, they will not reach the alternatives that we anyway have. Look at, again, the amaranth leaves, greens that they spray to death with the herbicides, 38.5, turmeric 67.5, neem, beautiful tree that I had to fight for because it had been patented. Neem has 25.3. The world has such abundance, and your movement that has resurrected collecting and gathering as a way human beings should meet their food needs, it can only be possible in a world of diversity. How is it that we've landed in a situation where 3,000% less efficient options, 7,000% less efficient options are offered as a miracle? I believe it's for two reasons. First, there has been a cultivation of what I have called the monoculture of the mind. If you only think of rice, then you want to put the vitamin A into rice. But when you think of diversity, then you know the greens and the, you know, why do we call it carotene? Because carrots are a major source of vitamin A. You think of all the wonderful vegetables. But there is another very, very big reason. Corporations that came out of a war system, a militarized system, don't just have a mindset of a militarized mind, but they have the operational strategies of a militarized mind. And I think one of the biggest threats we face, both to the biodiversity of the planet as well as to our food systems, is every tool is used to prevent the more sustainable, more healthy, more delicious alternatives from growing and prospering. So one of the things I've been doing since I started saving seeds is saving every kind of variety of food and now fiber plants that I can. We've created 110 community seed banks from where farmers can take the crops they need, because otherwise they have to pay royalties. And royalties are killing farmers. The only reason genetically modified crops are being pushed is in order to collect royalties. So let me give you the story of cotton. Cotton, which was the fiber of freedom, where Gandhi pulled out a spinning wheel and said, we are going to spin our way to freedom. We're not going to shoot our way to freedom. We'll spin our way to freedom. And when he was laughed at, and people said, how can a few pieces of wood bring you freedom. He says the only thing that can. Because the poorest person in the poorest hut can be active in the freedom movement. The spinning wheel is so small and can be fabricated. And everyone can spin freedom. So when I started to save seeds, it was the spinning wheel that was my inspiration. That if every one of us is saving diversity, if every one of us is protecting seeds, then these monopolies that are being thought of can't happen. I focused on food and I kind of didn't think of the fiber issue so much, and before you knew it, Monsanto had taken control of the cotton seed supply in India, the land from where cotton started. 95% of the cotton grown in India is now a genetically modified BT cotton. The costs of the seed jumped 8,000%. Instead of being renewable, the seed is non-renewable. Instead of being adapted, it is ill-adapted, so has to be bought many times over. It doesn't really work to control pests. The BT, you know, there are only two applications, a BT crop and a herbicide-resistant crop. Now, the BT crop has a toxic gene put into the plant, so every cell is producing the toxin all the time. This is supposed to control a pest called the bollworm. The bollworm is resistant, and new pests have been created. Farmers are spraying 13 times more pesticide today than they did before. The GMO cotton, which was supposed to be the end of spray. In the United States, the spread of herbicide-resistant crops has led to 70 million acres being overtaken by superweeds that can't be controlled. And now they're having to spray Roundup. They're having to spray Agent Orange in place of Roundup. Agent Orange, which was sprayed in Vietnam. And we saw the results there. But new research is showing that the glyphosate, which is the main ingredient of Roundup, is destroying the soil microorganisms, but also the beneficial bacteria in our gut. And pathogens are prospering. And lots of new research is showing the intestinal damage because of GM crops. There was a very, very famous scientist called Arpad Puzai in UK. Those of you who are from UK will remember. 1998, he was asked by the UK government to do studies. And his study showed the rats in his trials, the brains had shrunk, the pancreas had expanded, and the intestinal system was very, very damaged, and the immunity had collapsed. And his research institute went to the media, BBC broadcast this, and before you knew it, a call came from, you know, via White House. St. Louis is the headquarters of Monsanto, but they always operate via the White House. And he was fired, the top lecting expert of the world. Today he has a stroke, he's gone back to Hungary. He said, I left the communist Soviet Union because I wanted freedom. And I wanted to practice my science and freedom. I'm going back to Hungary because there's more freedom there than under corporate-controlled agriculture in the West. His life has been destroyed. Very famous scientist called Seralini, he did the only two-year study on GM feeding. And his research has shown huge occurrence of tumors in rats and also intestinal damage. In the US, there's a whole new syndrome called the leaky gut syndrome, that the intestinal walls are being so damaged. Because these are toxins, whether it's the Roundup Ready or the BT toxin, these are toxins. In India, 1,800 animals died after eating in the BT cotton fields. And the Animal Husbandry Department, when they did the autopsies, they found that the intestines were absolutely damaged and there was no digestion of the biomass. We did soil studies, and we find that all the soil organisms, the beneficial ones that degrade the biomass, are gone. Now, those same bacteria allow animals to digest the biomass in their stomachs. That's why the cows have four stomachs. And when those beneficial bacteria are gone in the gut, you're going to have all kinds of problems. So every time a good scientist, an independent scientist, does a piece of work, because science is dependent on public funding. It doesn't take very much for the corporations to cut off the strings every independent scientist I know has lost their job or their lab. Seralini has been told by the government, sorry, you'll have to close your lab by the end of this year. And what was his crime? He did good science. The only reason they can't take away a job from me because I gave it up on my own in 1982 to start the research foundation to do independent ecological work. So there's nothing they can take away from me. I gave it up voluntarily in any case. Today, we are in the strange situation where 72% of the food, according to the Food and Agriculture Organization, is coming from small farms, not from large industrial farms. Now, it's definitely easier to make a transition from the 72% to 100% by going diverse, by going local, by mixing every kind of innovative food tradition that all of you are engaged in. And yet, the industry that sees dollars in collecting royalties even while it pushes farmers into debt, and those debts push farmers to suicide. The figures from 1995 for farmer suicides in India have crossed 280,000. More than 250,000 Indian farmers have committed suicide because of debt, because of seed monopolies. Africa, it's like they want to recolonize that beautiful continent from where so much of the gift of food and the gift of humanity has been received. So not only is Mr. Bill Gates trying to get the Green Revolution into Africa through the Alliance for the Green Revolution in Africa, the G8 has just joined for a new investment, as if Africa's land was only for grabbing, as if Africa's seeds were only for grabbing. Sadly, even the Danish Prime Minister has made some strange comments recently that were sent to me by the Africans, saying Africans are primitive, they have no culture, and that is why we must take over. The white man's burden through food all over again. And for those of you who are interested, I can forward you the letters that the Africans have drafted and also some Danish citizens have drafted to make the Prime Minister see a little more about how rich Africa's agriculture is. And when it is practiced on ecological traditions, it can solve all the problems of hunger. The IASTD, the International Assessment of Agricultural Science and Technology for Development, 400 scientists worked 6 years, reviewed every piece of literature, and have said neither the Green Revolution nor genetic engineering can address the food issue. Only indigenous agriculture evolved constantly to the best of knowledge and agroecology and the combination of new emerging knowledge with the wisdom of centuries, that's the only solutions. 2 to 3 times more food we can grow. We have a study where we've taken real farms, where we work with the farmers, biodiverse ecological farms. 2 to 3 times more food we can produce by conserving diversity. We've always been made to believe you've got to wipe out what exists in order to feed humanity. We have to conserve every species, every bee, every butterfly, every earthworm, every microorganism, both for themselves as well as for us. The web of life is a food web. And any system of food that destroys the web of life is not worthy of being called a food system. It should be called truthfully by its name, a war system. We've got to have the guts and the courage to know the truth and to speak the truth. That this is a system that is creating hunger. This is a system that has given disease to 2 billion people. The FAO just announced that $4.3 trillion is the cost of obesity because of eating stuff that wasn't meant to be eaten. It's not food. I call it non-food. Just as I call non-renewable seed, non-seed. The meaning of seed in every language, at least I know my own, Bija, means that which renews. How can seed that is not allowed to be renewed be called seed? It is a commodity, it is a lie because it was never created by Monsanto. Monsanto polluted it with BT toxin genes and Roundup Ready genes, and normally in environmental law, a polluter must pay, not get rewarded with monopolies. So in the next few years, and if we were to say in the next 15 years, let's take the challenge, all of us, from the different places we come, from the chefs and the farmers and the mothers and the grandmothers and the scientists and the musicians, let's take a commitment that we'll work to make the 72% food system, that is the beneficial system, 100%, with no place for giant corporations to control the food, no place for patenting of seed, no place for toxic chemicals, no place for GMOs. Now, you know, the early days, I'm old enough to have been in this movement, 40 years actually. It was the chefs that came out first against GMOs. And I think every one of you, whether you do pop-up restaurants or you do fancy restaurants, I really feel you should have in your menus on your doorstep, GMO-free, patent-free, freedom food. Because if food has to be free, seed has to be free. How can it be patented? How can it be mutilated? How can it be poisoned? And every year now, we defend food freedom and seed freedom with intensive coordinated action to become one, even while we are local and diverse in our everyday lives. 2nd October, the day Gandhi taught us, Gandhi's birth anniversary, but he taught us that as long as unjust laws and brutal laws are obeyed, so long will slavery exist. And if we've got to have freedom, then we have to have the courage and the guts to say no to unjust law. That's what I practice. That's how we've prevented bad laws from being put into place in India. But the European Commission, 6th May, has drafted a law to make it illegal to have your own seed for your own garden, so that the only seed available will be the corporate seed, the industrial seed, the bad seed, the non-seed, the anti-seed. So join in the campaign. And 16th October is World Food Day. Let's remind the world who feeds the world. Let's honor the real food heroes. Monsanto's just given itself the award for World Food Day, for feeding the world. And we need to honor the real food heroes. Everyone who's bringing good food and nourishment. And the beauty of our movement, our revolution, is that it can be practiced in such diverse ways. More important, that we don't have to be miserable while practicing it. We get joy, we get beauty, we get taste, we get quality, and we cultivate freedom. And I would like to leave a set of gifts for Noma, of course, the banana. But we have a big movement called Forgotten Foods, bringing to the center stage foods that are really the more generous foods, like the millets, like the amaranth. And because India gave rice to the world, we used to have 200,000 rice varieties. Each of these books has recipes at the end, as well as the diversity. And our story about seed saving and the health per acre, that we don't have to poison our deaf selves to death. We can nourish ourselves to life. Thank you so much.